I've prepared a lecture for you guys on the history of television in Japan. As I'm sure you're aware, film developed before television developed. So in Japan, regular TV broadcasts began in 1953, although there were sporadic attempts at TV before that. The major channels were NHK, and then shortly after that, NTV started up. They took two different approaches. So the NHK's approach was money through receiver fees, and so they were encouraging the sales of TVs, which, of course, especially in the beginning when TVs were still quite expensive, that was difficult. There were a lot of people that couldn't easily invest the large amount of money in having a TV at home. However, NTV took a different approach. They were looking to get money through advertisements, so they encouraged the sales of the things that were advertised on the TV. And that meant that in order to reach more people and to drive more business to the companies that paid for advertising, they promoted public TV sets. So these could be TVs anywhere. They could be in a cafe or whatever, but they could also be in a train station, for example. Public sets, for a time anyway, replaced movie watching. And a lot of the early staff for the TV stations were people who used to work with films. But this became a problem for the film companies, who felt very threatened. So as TV took the audience from film, then film companies forbade their talent from appearing on TV. The way that the system used to work is that if you were an actor or an actress, you would actually sign a contract with a TV station or with a film company, and you would repeatedly appear in the products made by that TV station or by that film company. And so originally the film companies hadn't forbade their stars from appearing on TV, but later they did. And from 1956, they also forbade movies from being broadcast, or their movies from being broadcast on TV. Unfortunately, there were consequences for the film companies. First, TV developed its own styles and stars, and that differentiated it from film. And so there were stars that people would never see in films and that they would want to see and continue watching, and they would then repeatedly turn to TV. And other kinds of things in terms of styles, for example, because of the small size of the screen on the TVs, shooting style kind of premiered these extreme close-ups so that you could really see somebody's face, really see somebody's expression. And because of all the competition from the TV stations, the film industry eventually couldn't stay afloat, and a lot of major studios, sorry, that says studies, major studios went under, and the films ended up being broadcast on TV because, with the company no longer able to preserve their own market. By the 1960s, Japanese tech companies were mass manufacturing TVs, as we can watch in this video clip. And the mass production of TVs, and consequently the increasingly lower price for TVs, facilitated mass viewership of TV. There had been a lot of discussion in Japanese society and in other societies, actually, around the world, about how film threatened society because private feelings were aired in public spaces, how this sort of encouraged a erosion of public dignity, or how this encouraged emotionalism and showed bad examples of how to live and so on. The discourse in Japan said that TV threatened society through elimination of public spaces. After there was mass production of televisions and people were watching TV at home, then people were spending less time doing things in groups, like enjoying communal society. So as TV managed to make itself indispensable for the nation, TV viewers watched national spectacles like the Tokyo Olympics from home instead of in some sort of, mass enjoyment of the spectacle. Viewers consumed the nation through TV, and they had a growing awareness of what the nation was and how one was supposed to think about it was communicated through the TV set. And the problem there is that national messages entered the home without the mediation of public spaces. So you didn't have somebody telling you that this discourse could be false, or causing you to question the discourse, or actively giving you other sources of information. Instead, TV viewership was seen as much more passive, where the message that was communicated through the TV was just accepted by the viewer without question. However, there are plenty of scholars since who have argued that audiences are active and that they create meaning for themselves. But those arguments about active audiences came after this concern about watching TV making people too susceptible to perhaps nationalist propaganda that was on TV or whatever. So the development Japanese television developed sort of repetitive forms of narration that could accommodate distracted viewing practices of the housewife. That was one of the things where you see the same scene shown to you again, or you see the words appearing on the screen that, you know, you won't miss the important point because you're going to be shown it again and again. National networks developed, and they were centered in Tokyo, so you had a sort of standardization of national culture based on Tokyo culture. And a lot of the images that came through the TV bolstered a sort of idea that Japan was all middle class, that everybody was middle class, everybody was doing well, which of course is not true. But there was a creation of these sort of rituals of uniform viewing, such as the annual New Year's Red White Song Competition and Ocean. We previously watched a clip from Ocean in class. Maybe you remember, it was a family drama from Japan. And I'm going to show you a little bit of the Red White Song Competition right now.
NHK紅白歌合戦 さあ、それでは頑張りましょう。 お二人の選手代表
選手先生でございます。よろしくどうぞ。先生。それでは始めます。あの笑顔が戻ってきました。紅白初出場です。
The television system in Japan is basically supported by two things. One is commercials, and the other one is the talent system. So commercial films in Japan are so important, they can make a star's career. The commercial films have also, over time, become better than many of the programs. Just like in Korea, there are people who actively follow CFs and watch them repeatedly, watch making ofs and everything else. Exposure is the most important thing to actually making a talent into a star, not actual talent. So being in CFs then becomes incredibly important. From the 1980s, Japan developed a really extensive series of variety TV programs, and most of these appealed to the viewer through simulation of sort of inside jokes, or another way we can think of this is intertextuality. So this is the start of the extreme intertextuality of Japanese TV that we still see today. Both Japanese TV and Korean TV has that intertextuality as a major component, as a distinctive part of the system. And the televisual style in general in Japan has created an economics of attention, which is an idea, this economics of attention is an idea that I've frequently used in my own work. I really enjoy this concept. So what happened to film? So as TV became the major entertainment, then film looked to try to find alternative ways of popularity or alternative ways to make money. One of the things they did is they targeted young male viewers with sex and violence that you couldn't see on TV because there are a lot of rules about, you know, what kind of things people could see on television. And this led to a lot of different things. One thing, J-horror, developed more because that was one of the ways of creating live action films that you could actually get people to go to the movie theater to watch since they couldn't see those on TV. And J-horror eventually became known to international horror fans. And many Japanese horror movies have been remade around the world, including in Hollywood. And anime films also gained worldwide audiences during this time period. So even mainstream films also turned to making blue films as a way to stay afloat. And by blue films, I mean making porn. The market share for Japanese films dropped from 78.3% of the market in 1960 to 27.1% in 2002. It's rebounded since. 2016 was the highest. And you can see with the 2017 figures, you can see how much of the movie market was just purely by one company, Toho. And so there are three major studios. Toho's really dominant overall. But the total number of theaters and screens in theaters is shrinking in Japan due to video on demand. And so long-term, what's going to happen to the film industry in Japan or even around the world, since video on demand is an issue everywhere, still remains to be seen.